number. They can lead you on. We don't ever know what's ahead in our future. But the one thing we do know, our God knows. He knows how to provide a way of escape in the time of temptation. You can trust God. Let's turn to the book of Obadiah. Book of Obadiah. It's not a book that we go to very often. It's just a one chapter book, and he sits right in between Amos and Jonah.
Hallelujah! Thank you, Lord.
Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Most of the time we feel like there's not a whole lot in Obadiah that would apply to us, but there's a whole lot in Obadiah. You can do a whole teaching just on Obadiah, and I'm not doing that. But I just want to hit a couple of scriptures here to set us up for our message for this morning. But while we try to find Obadiah in the Bible, he is in there. Between Amos and Jonah. But while we try to find him, I want to make a little Bible connection with Obadiah, so we can understand how he connects with the rest of the Bible. Obadiah gave a prophecy against Edom. Edom is the same as Esau. Esau, we know, was Jacob's brother. They was twins, and when they came out, it was prophesied that the older would serve the younger. So it was prophesied that Esau, or Edom, would serve the younger.
Yeah.
All along, since that time, there has been fights and wars and scrabbles and everything over power with these two. And so Obadiah gives a prophecy against Edom. Edom even connects to our Christmas story. He connects to Easter. For Herod, when the wise men came and asked, where is he that is born king of the Jews? That Herod, who was given the title by Romans to be king of the Jews, was an Edomite. So this prophecy was against him. Now he died, Jesus came back, but his lineage continued, and so the Herod, who was king of the Jews during Jesus' crucifixion, was an Edomite. He died.
Yes, Jesus.
It continued, and the Herod, who persecuted the church and beheaded James, was an Edomite. Wow. So all of this continues from Exodus on in to actually into Revelations.
Yeah.
But now let us get going. So we see that it's not just a random chapter somewhere.
Amen.
So the book of Obadiah, and we're going to look at verse 15 and verse 21 first, and then we're going to back up and hit two more verses. Verse 15, so the book of Obadiah, verses 1 through 14, is what Obadiah did. Not Obadiah. What the Edomites did. And what they did was, they was constantly fighting their brother and treating their brother wrong. The last half, verses 15 through 21, is God's response to what Edom did. So verse 15 says, for the day of the Lord is near upon all the heathen. As thou hast done, it shall be done unto thee, and thy reward shall return upon thine own head. Verse 21 says, and Savior shall come up on Mount Zion to judge the mount of Esau, and the kingdom shall be the Lord's. So what I did is I read the Lord's response first. And the end of the prophecy is God's in charge. The end of the prophecy is all of this is going to belong to God. And the kingdom shall belong to the Lord. He introduced in verse 15 the day of the Lord. The day of the Lord is the day that Jesus Christ leaves heaven and returns back to earth again in judgment and in wrath. That is when this prophecy will be fulfilled. Amen. All right, now, what did the Edomites do? Verse 3. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee. Thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? Verse 4. Thou shalt exalt, though thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and though thou set thy nest among the stars, thence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord.
Amen.
So here we're set up. Edomites, because of pride, have set themselves up and have tried to go against the prophecies of God. We can go to Genesis, the third chapter now. This is really where the message is at. Genesis, the third chapter.
Amen.
So Edomites through pride. Pride, who is the author of pride? Satan.
Yes, he is.
This same pride is the same deceptive lies that Satan works on us today.
Amen.
The reason I wanted to start with the Edomites and prophecy of Obadiah is to show how long pride will keep us in sin. How long pride will keep us deceived. When I say us, don't think I'm not talking about just sinners, because I'm talking about pride. I'm talking about church members. Because we can allow pride to reach into our heart. And when pride begins to grow up in our heart, we're just as susceptible to the lies of Satan as anybody else. So when we look at the lies of Satan, let's look back at the very beginning and how this man, Satan, started everything off. So the message is, your fig leaf is too short. Your fig leaf is too short.
Yes, Jesus.
And don't get it confused. I'm not talking about somebody's dress walking down the street. I'm talking about your spiritual dress and how you look to God. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 7. Verses 1 through 7 is where Satan comes along and begins to talk to Eve and begin to beguile her, begins to deceive her. And what he begins working on is her pride. But see, what did Eve know about pride? Eve didn't know about pride because Eve was pure. But Satan knew pride, and he knew, if I can get her mind to start thinking about herself more than what she really is, I've got her. And so he begins to talk to her, and as he does, he asks the question, hath God said? The first thing that pride begins to cause us to do is to question what we really know about God.
Amen.
And if Satan can get us to question what we know, question what we've been taught, then pride will begin to continue to grow. And after a while, we'll just drop what we know and follow our own will.
Amen.
So he began to ask, hath God said? And she began to consider, she said, well, yeah, God has said. Now in the fifth verse, Satan talking to Eve says, for God doth know that in the day ye eat thereof. Stop right there. Who gave Satan the right to determine what God knows? And you see, that is the essence of pride. When we begin to determine what God knows, what God meant, what God could have, should have said, and how what God said applies to me, that's the very church today.
Satan,
talking to Eve, says, God knows. How many times will Satan talk to us, church folks, when we know I've done my brother wrong? What did the Edomites do? They did their brother wrong. And by pride, they continue to do their brother wrong. And are still today doing their brother wrong. But God will have the last say. But church, we're still living right now today. And when we do our brother wrong, our sister wrong, pride sets in. And Satan will begin to talk to us and say, God knows. God knows you didn't really mean it that way, so don't worry about it. God knows what's truly in your heart, and you're not as bad as you feel like you are right now. God knows. That is nothing but the deception of the devil when he begins to tell you God knows. If your thought process is starting off, well, God knows. And that thought process is an excuse for what I'm doing. That's nothing but pride. And what will God do with pride? Oh, he's going to tear it down. You can go on for a long time. But Obadiah said, God's going to tear that down.
Amen.
God doth know.
He does.
He does know. But not the way Satan was bringing it up. Alright, so he goes on with his lie. He says, your eyes shall be opened so that you will know good and evil. That same lie, he's working today. Your eyes will be open. You will understand what's right and what's wrong. Because Satan will make you feel like you understand
what's right and what's wrong.
The deception he gave to Eve is Eve. God's actually trying to hold you back. You can be better than what you are being told you can be. And he's giving young people that same thing today. He's giving old people that same thing today. He's giving church members that same thing today. He is giving church ministers that same thing today. He's giving church choir members that same thing today. That you can be more, you should be more than what you are. They haven't given you the title that you should have. They're not letting you do the thing that you should be able to do. And God knows that you should be better than what you are, but you're not going to get there unless you listen to what I say. The deception of the devil hasn't changed. Why do people spend so long in sin? Right there. Pride. And because of pride, we buy into what the devil is deceiving us with. And so we sing on the choir with all of these thoughts in our heart. We preach with all of these thoughts in our heart. We testify with all these thoughts in our heart. Or we come to church a sinner and leave a sinner because of these thoughts in our heart. And God isn't able to do anything because of pride that's working within our heart. You can't get saved with pride in your heart. You can't receive the full favor and blessing of God with pride in your heart. Because pride God hates, and he will tear it down. And the end of the prophecy is God's kingdom will rule. God will rule. So when we go on with the story, Adam and Eve didn't eat. They gave in to the lie and they raped. I'm naked.
Yeah.
They had been naked all along.
Yes.
But now their eyes was open. They could perceive good and evil.
Yes.
And they declared themselves to be naked.
Yeah.
And so they made fig leaves so that they could clothe themselves and feel better. All Satan has to offer you is a fig leaf.
Yeah.
And your fig leaf is too short. When God calls your name.
Yeah.
Or you come into a day when God is going to call your name.
Yeah.
And when you come to that day, all you're going to have is a fig leaf.
Yeah.
And Adam said, when I heard your voice, I hid myself.
Yeah.
All right, yeah.
Think about it.
Yeah. Adam had already made the fig leaf.
Uh-huh.
He was already dressed in his fig leaf. And he felt like I'm okay if my fig leaf.
Yeah.
That's the deception of Satan.
Yeah.
That he will have you in today.
Yeah.
Is that you're all right with your fig leaf.
You can
use a fig leaf to patch up your nice white garment. You get a little wrinkle, a little dirty spot on your nice pure white soul. Patch it up with a little fig leaf. Put that fig leaf up there and work it in so it works the wrinkle out real good. And he's going to have you feeling like I'm okay with my fig leaf. People have alcohol problems. People have sex problems. People have drug problems. People have problems with depression. People have problems with anxiety. People have had problems with grief. People have problems. I can keep on with my depression. I'm okay with that because God knows and understands who I am.
All right. Yes.
It's a fig leaf.
Yes.
It's a fig leaf.
Yes.
My anxiety issues. God knows that.
Uh-huh.
It's a fig leaf.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Pornography.
Yes.
God knows that I just got all of these desires and God knows that he created me. That's nothing but a lie from the devil letting you know that you have the right to determine what God knows and that you have the right to determine what is evil and what is good. And then he offers you a fig leaf. Dressing your life up with a fig leaf. And when God your fig leaf is too short.
Too short. Too short.
Yeah, man.
Really, brother.
Yeah, you're right.
Nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Nothing but the blood
is able to cover all those problems. Nothing but the blood can wash my garments and make them pure. Church without spot, without a wrinkle, without any type of fig leaves attached to the spiritual garment, because a fig leaf is too short and it won't cover up that sin that you have been trying to hide for so long. It's time to get out of sin. Remove those fig leaves from all. We can have a change within our heart. We can have a change within our feelings. We can have a change in the things that we do. And the things that we do will glorify God. And then God knows. Yeah, then you can speak the truth. God
it requires the blood.
Yeah, that's right.
You see, when Adam got up to God, God says, "What? Where are you?" Adam said, "Well, I heard your voice, and I got scared because I was naked."
All right.
But Adam, you got fig leaves on. Who told you your name?
Who told you?
You want to know who told Adam he was naked? The voice of God. Well, the devil didn't tell him he was naked.
No.
The voice of God.
Yeah.
Though you're dressed with fig leaves, when you hear the voice of God, you're going to recognize how naked you are. Sinner man, sinner woman, when you hear the voice of God call your name, no matter what excuse you've been operating under, you're going to recognize how naked that excuse really was in your life. Because God has given us today, and God has supplied the blood of Jesus to wash and cleanse and make us whole. Brother Vern has already asked us, let's tarry in a little while around these altars. But church, let's do that. Because I have to believe that sometimes church members, we've got some fig leaves attached to us that we need to get rid of. We've got some things in our life that we've been excusing away. And sometimes we've been making excuses for years. Thinking that fig leaf is going to keep it covered. No, you're going to find yourself naked at the voice of God. Spend some time around the altar and give God thanks for the blood of Jesus. For when Adam came to Jesus, God killed a beast. God shed some blood. And he clothed Adam with animal skin. You see, God will clothe you right. So that when he calls your name, you won't be naked. And I just have to believe that as God was killing that beast, he was letting Adam and Eve know, you see, that fig leaf isn't going to work for you. You need more than a fig leaf to dress up your problem. Your problem has to come under the blood. And he killed that beast and let the blood run out. And as that blood was running out, he might have let him know, there's coming a day. There's coming a day when I'm going to send my only begotten son. And when that day comes, well, yeah, man is going to kill him just like I'm killing this beast. Man is going to let his blood run down just like blood is running out of this beast. But that blood, Adam, is shed for your sin. It's shed for my sin. It's shed for your sin so that